weapons of mass destruction, no power.
No one can make an intelligent decision without being properly informed. This is why this world wants to control the media. This is why media hype can take you up,
take you down.
So you don't know anymore who's really good, because the media can make a wicked man look good and make a good man look evil. That is why. Until the dawn, I can't quit. I'm like Saddam, keeping my eye on Clinton, watching each movie he makes. Cause every slither he takes sort of reminds.
Good evening, welcome, peace, Abarigani Hotep, Assalam Alaikum. You are watching a special edition of the Final Call News Hour. The Final Call News Hour is the partner of the Final Call newspaper and the Final Call online edition that you can get digitally at finalcalldigital.com. I am your illustrious host, Brother Herman Muhammad, and welcome, welcome, welcome to the program. Tonight we have a very special program. We're going to be going, coming out of, I want to show you two issues of the paper, right? But we're going to be concentrating specifically on one. The current edition of the Final Call newspaper reads, Black families, children under siege. Agencies that are supposed to protect children and unite families are snatching children from parents and hurting our community, advocates warn. And that story begins on page 5 of this great edition of the Final Call newspaper. The other edition that I'm going to primarily come out of is entitled, it's the one that came right before this one, and it's entitled 911, 20 years of questions, lies, and deaths. And coverage, of course, begins on page 3. Again, I am your man, your brother, your friend, Brother Herman Muhammad, and welcome to the Final Call News Hour. We're going to, like I said, we're going to start out of this issue 911, which we just commemorated this past Saturday. I definitely don't want to say celebrate it, because we can't celebrate the death or the deaths of some 3,000 people, and subsequently the deaths, plural, of hundreds of thousands more with these ensuing wars. But this coverage begins on page 3 of this edition of the Final Call. Let me show it to you one more time. 911, 20 years of questions, lies, and deaths. And of course, you can get either one of those issues. And I would encourage you to go to finalcalldigital.com and sign up for the digital edition of the Final Call newspaper. It comes to your tablet, it comes to your phone, it comes to your laptop or your Mac. And man, it's just a phenomenal tool for getting information that you can't get anywhere else. Like I always say, man, the Final Call newspaper is the most widely circulated black owned and operated publication in the world, and it also serves as the communications organ for the Nation of Islam. It's news that you can use, it's news that is uncompromising, it's news that is fact checked and that you can believe, man. It comes from a trusted source. In fact, the publisher of the world famous Final Call newspaper is none other than the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. So pick that up, man. Pick up those latest editions of the Final Call newspaper. Now we're going to jump right into it. And again, this story begins on page 3. And it's very important because it ties right into what's going on right now with COVID-19. And if you're coming into the room and you're watching this on Facebook Live, you know, let's get some hearts, let's get some thumbs up. You know, we just want to engage. If you're coming into the room and you're watching this on YouTube, if they allow the video to go up, YouTube been really tripping as of late, but it's cool. We're going to keep on rolling. If you're coming into the room and YouTube, let's get some thumbs up, thumbs down. I don't care. Likes, dislikes. Let's just engage. Share, subscribe, because this information you're not going to get from anywhere else. And it's not about Brother Herman. It's about what's in the Final Call newspaper. So yeah, check in. So this story on page 3 of this edition of the Final Call newspaper is entitled Lies, Loss, Death, and Destruction, 20 Years of Post-911 Misery. Lies, Loss, Death, and Destruction, 20 Years of Post-911 Misery. And it's written by our brother and friend who is the editor-in-chief of the Final Call, the managing editor, Brother Nabah Muhammad, and Brother Brian E. Muhammad. And of course, they can be reached on Twitter at The Final Call. And it starts out, 20 years have passed since jumbo jets flew into New York City's World Trade Center on September 11, 2001. In horror, the world watched the implosion of the Twin Towers, followed by reports of passenger planes striking the Pentagon outside of Washington, D.C., and going down in Pennsylvania. On that day, 3,000 people perished, changing reality for Americans and millions around the world in different ways. 9/11 was so momentous an event that many who lived it remember what they were doing and where they were that Tuesday at 8:46 a.m. Eastern Standard Time when tragedy struck. The hours, days, weeks, and months after the attack brought stories of the best of America surfacing and praise for firefighters, police, and EMT professionals who were injured, died, and lost colleagues, answering the call to save lives in New York. It also left many Americans crying for blood and the president vowing to give them blood. Now, I could definitely bear witness that on that day, I definitely remember where I was when those planes entered into those buildings, when that plane, or so-called plane, entered into the Pentagon, and when that so-called plane, or I'll say it was a plane, but was so-called crashed in that field in Pennsylvania. But there's another side to it. Because we know, in hindsight, a lot of times provides 20/20 vision. And many of us know and understand, based upon the facts that have come out after 911, it wasn't exactly what they said it was. And there's a brother in this article named Mari Salakhan, who Brother Richard and Brother Brian quote. And he says, the tragedy of 9/11 is a tragedy on many levels, said Mari Salakhan of the Afia Sadiq Foundation, a Muslim human rights group. It's a tragedy for this nation vis-a-vis what this nation is supposed to represent theoretically as a nation with liberty and justice for all. Mr. Salakhan said, 9/11 exposed deep, ever-present contradictions in America's well-crafted image as a bastion of freedom. The U.S. government moved swiftly to attach blame for the deadly act. Officials said the enemies were Arabs, Muslims who acted out of hatred for America's freedoms. And it goes on to talk about how they blame Osama bin Laden and whatnot. But I want to stop there just for a second and just talk about why I wanted to do this show and why this Final Call newspaper, this edition, is so very important, and why each and every one of us should either get a hard copy of it or, again, log on to Final Call digital.com and pick yours up. It's important because I want to lay a foundation here for what I'm going to say a little bit later on. It's important because we're living in a time where there's a lot of wool being pulled over people's eyes. There's a lot of deceit going on. There's a lot of lying happening for an agenda that we might not know. We didn't know at the time when those planes hit those buildings that it was going to be used as a way for the government and America to really go to war against the entire Muslim world. We didn't know that. But they were preparing us for something. It used 911. 911 allowed the government to use our fear to have us surrender certain rights. Many of you who are watching this, and if you're coming into the room, like, share, subscribe, thumbs up, thumbs down, just engage. Many of you were not born 20 years ago. Many of you are that young, or maybe you are just too young to remember what happened and how the country changed after 9/11. Before 9/11, we didn't have to take our shoes and our belts off to go through the airport, as if taking your shoes off is going to make us more secure. Or taking your belt. See, it changed things. They were preparing us to surrender certain freedoms by using fear. The fear of Muslims, the fear of Arabs, the fear of so-called terrorists coming to this country because they hate our freedoms and killing us based upon that fact. But it didn't begin with 9/11. It actually started a little earlier. They've been driving us with fear for quite some time. Before that, many of you might not be old enough to remember this, but I, of course, I experienced this as well. In 1999, before the year 2000, they called it the Y2K debacle. They were saying to the public, and when I say they, I'm saying the government, officials, specialists, experts, those who we so-called trust. They were saying to the American people that Y2K, or the year 2000, was going to be some sort of disaster because somehow modern technology, the computers that we had, could not distinguish 1999 from 2000. I mean, it sounds absurd now. But they had us going out buying, stocking up on food and stocking up on water and getting batteries. Like, 2000, the year 2000, January 1, like, everything was gonna go haywire because the computers were gonna stop working. Our power was gonna be cut off. Our phones wouldn't work anymore. Nothing was gonna work anymore because it was gonna be chaos because computers couldn't make the transition from 1999 to 2000. This is real talk. If I'm lying, I'm flying. And any of you watching this, please bear me witness. Thumbs up, comment, you know, let somebody know that what I'm saying is the truth. But of course, 2000 came and went, even though many of us went out and stocked up, got water, got batteries for our flashlights, went loaded up on bullets for our guns. 2000 came and went, and you know, we all survived. Matter of fact, it was non-incidental whatsoever. But the powers that be were using fear to move us in a certain direction. Just like on 9/11, they used the attacks on the World Trade Center to use fear to motivate us to give up certain freedoms vis-a-vis the Patriot Act, which was that act that they came with that allowed us to give up so many different freedoms. Now let me read you something else in this final call about what happened. This is another person quoted about what happened after 9/11. His name is Kevin Barrett. Kevin Barrett of Veterans Today and an author believes none of the war on terror hype and calls 9/11 a false flag operation that triggered years of adverse events and war in Afghanistan and Iraq. A false flag is a covert operation designed to deceive and create the appearance of a particular party, group, or nation being responsible for some activity while disguising the actual source of the action. Now, this is very interesting because a false flag operation. That's why I'm saying they used this to further an agenda that you and I and the American people knew nothing about. In fact, the article goes on to talk about how they blamed Osama bin Laden, who at that time was in Afghanistan being harbored by the Taliban. This is the first time in history that we also ever heard of Al-Qaeda, which was the terrorist organization headed by Osama bin Laden that no one knew anything about until 9/11. Now, what's interesting about Osama bin Laden, it's Osama bin Laden and Brother Richard and Brother Brian going to the into the in this article, used to be an ally of the United States. He used to fight with the Mujahideen who drove the Soviet Union out of Afghanistan. And at that time, in the 80s, Osama bin Laden was partnering with the CIA to drive the Soviets out of Afghanistan. That was America's interest. But flash forward to 2001, now Osama bin Laden has turned into an enemy and he's responsible for terrorist acts all over the world. Now, the thing about Osama bin Laden and other terrorists that one must know and understand is that a terrorist, Osama bin Laden, Al-Qaeda, different terrorist organizations, whenever they commit an act, they use it as a recruiting tool to pull in more terrorists into their network. Well, when 9/11 went down and they eventually blamed Osama bin Laden, and it was actually not even eventually, it was almost immediate, which drew some other questions. When they blamed Osama bin Laden, Here's a person who takes responsibility for every act that he commits because, again, it's used as a recruiting tool for terrorist organizations. But interestingly enough, when they blamed Osama bin Laden for 9/11, which was the largest terrorist act ever committed on American soil, he did not claim responsibility. In fact, he denied doing it. He congratulated those who did do it, but he himself said he didn't do it. Which lends to the conspiracy. Because before 9/11, the government, with all of its intelligence agencies and apparatuses, didn't know anything. But the day after 9/11, they knew everything. They knew the names of all 19 terrorists who hijacked these planes using box cutters, little baby razors. They hijacked. This is the story now. This is the narrative. 19 hijackers simultaneously hijacked 4 planes with box cutters. At the same time, taking control, flying them into the World Trade Centers, the Pentagon, and one that got shot down. Oh, I won't say got. It looks like it got shot down. But one that crashed in Pennsylvania, allegedly headed for the White House. And this is what this is the narrative that they sold the American people. We watched in horror as the Twin Towers, which had got hit by planes, subsequently a few hours later, come down in what appeared to be a controlled implosion. And the official story was that the planes that hit the building at the top of the towers, that the jet fuel was so hot that it caused all the, I guess, the steel in these buildings to melt, and they came down in a very controlled way. Now, there are engineers and there are architects, thousands of them, who said that it could not have happened that way. But that was still the official story of the government. Look, man, we're talking about this edition of the Final Call newspaper. 9/11, 20 years of questions, lies, and deaths. And the stuff, man, the story that they told us, of course, now it don't make no damn sense, but it's still the official narrative. But I want to take it a step forward, further. Because there are going to be some of you who say, oh, Brother Herman, you're the conspiracy theorist. Dude, these people, these terrorists hit us, and you probably sympathize with some of them Muslims. Because you one of them. Okay. Them buildings, the planes, the jet fuel was just that hot where they melted and caused the buildings to fall down. Yet the second building that got hit fell before the first building that got hit, interestingly enough. But more questionable, which has been pointed out by architects and engineers and people who do not believe the official narrative of the United States government. More questionable is the implosion of building number 7. Building number 7 was another building in New York, part of the World Trade Center complex, that collapsed, yet no plane hit it. There were no official bombs or anything set off by any other terrorist. But the building fell all by itself, just like the World Trade Centers. Some of y'all saying, man, I never heard that, Brother Herman. Well, we're going to bring the receipts on the Final Call News Hour tonight. So here's footage. And remember, this is a building that nothing hit. No planes hit. No bombs exploded, so they say. It just fell. They say it fell because somehow the building caught on fire. Not with jet fuel, but regular fire. And the building just collapsed. So this is footage of Building 7. And we'll come back and talk about it. In the background, plumes from the World Trade Centers. See the fire? Again, you saw some fire, but the building imploded, just like you would see. Google controlled implosions, if you think I'm lying. Nothing hit that building, family. And that was hours after the planes hit the World Trade Centers. Hours. So, what I'm saying, family, is question everything. Understand that there is an agenda going on. And I want to read further in the article, because Minister Akbar Muhammad, who's the international representative of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan in the Nation of Islam, has some very interesting spiritual insight. And let me read what Brother Minister Akbar says. Minister Akbar said, it's also important to understand the spiritual context 9/11 sprang from, the subsequent events, and that it occurred during the prophecy time of America's decline and fall as a power. He referenced the warnings and guidance to America and the world nations by the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the eternal leader of the Nation of Islam, and his student and national representative, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. It's all signs, said Minister Akbar Muhammad, referring to America's quote-unquote unraveling, both domestically and internationally. When you get a sign and are heedless to the warning, you pay a price. He said, you will be foolish not to see the hand of the Almighty in what is happening to the world and America in particular. The 9/11 remembrance comes while America is beset with manifest loss from a COVID-19 pestilence, weather calamities, and military defeat. Abdul Akbar Muhammad said people should consult the scriptures of Bible and Holy Quran to understand why America is losing. And just man, that's so powerful, man. Brother Akbar's words are so powerful. Rewind that and listen to me say that again. But he continues, Elijah Muhammad, in his pivotal book, The Fall of America, wrote that the United States would reap what she has sown on the world stage. She is destined to never win a war again. America is losing control of her world. In desperation, she feels that her guns, rockets, bombs, and technology will keep her kingdom in power, he warned. And that's exactly what then President George W. Bush used 911 to do. He used it to push an aggressive military policy against the Muslim world. He went to Afghanistan to get Osama bin Laden, which he never did. Osama bin Laden was eventually killed under Barack Obama's administration. But he used it to wage a war on so-called terror, which really was a war on Islam. Instead of seeking out the truth, and we know why he didn't, but just ask your questions. Why instead of staying in Afghanistan where Osama bin Laden was, why this war on terror led him to Iraq and Saddam Hussein, who had absolutely nothing to do with the 9/11 terror attacks, and hundreds of thousands of Muslims and innocents being murdered because of America's errant foreign policy. This is real, man. And then we're bringing this right up to COVID-19 because it ties right in. Now, I want to read this because this is very important and very powerful. And if you're coming into the room again, like, share, subscribe. Brother Richard, or Brother Naban, Brother Brian Wright, in 20 years of post-911 wars in Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, Yemen, Somalia, and Pakistan, America spent an estimated $8 trillion and killed more than 929,000 people. Just let that marinate. They spent an estimated $8 trillion and killed more than 929,000 people in Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, Yemen, Somalia, and Pakistan over the last 20 years. In Afghanistan alone, they spent $2.6 trillion. Or $2.3 trillion, excuse me. Now, think about $8 trillion spent in 20 years and all of the homeless people you see walking around your cities and your streets and where you live, and how that money could have been used to do something about that problem. Think about that $8 trillion. Think about it. Now, I'm going to end on this with a quote from a brother who along with Jill Stein, ran as vice president to her running for president a couple of elections ago. The 21st century was supposed to be the century of America, said Ajama Baraka, national organizer with the Black Alliance for Peace. That fantasy was ruined by America, fueled by colonialist hubris and belief she could fight two major wars simultaneously in Afghanistan and Iraq. What they ended up doing was not only losing those wars, but exposing the U.S. as a paper tiger, said Mr. Baraka. So instead of the U.S. 21st century being the century of U.S. power, it will be the century of U.S. decline. And what we're seeing is, in just 20 years, the precipitous decline of the U.S., said Mr. Baraka. That, to me, is what signifies the 20-year anniversary of 9/11. And what it also points to, family, is what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said about America and where she was headed. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, predicted the fall of America. And I'm here to tell you that the commemoration of 9/11, along with the COVID-19 pandemic, along with these weather disasters that are going on and on and on and on, Ida and Ryan and all of these different hurricanes running through, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan both predicted. The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, as a matter of fact, in his July 4, 2020 address entitled The Criterion, which you can see at noi.org, said to a moment, to an event, what will be going on right now. Pay attention, family. Ask questions. We're talking about this current edition of the Final Call newspaper. 9/11, 20 years of questions, lies, and deaths. We want to ask questions about what really happened on 9/11. That's the most important thing. Because, 3,000 Americans lost their lives. And that is huge. That is terrible. But we also cannot forget that 929,000 Muslims and innocents lost their lives subsequent to that. All at the hands of the United States government. So, I want to ask a question about COVID-19. Because we know that Y2K was about feeding fear. We know that 9/11 was about feeding fear, using fear to motivate us to give up certain rights. Could it be? And this is just a question. YouTube, probably gonna kill my channel after this. They threatened to kill my channel, but that's all right. Y'all like, share, and subscribe anyway until they kill it. Could COVID-19 be a fear play to give you to relinquish? You've already given up certain personal freedoms for security. Now, will you give up medical freedoms for your own so-called safety from a virus that they cannot stop? The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, let me give you a picture of him again, in his July 4th address, told us that they would not be able to stop COVID-19 with their vaccine. They would not be able to stop it, that it was a pestilence sent from heaven, that God is in control of this. That's what he said. God is in control, and that the only way that you can stop it is that you repent. Joe Biden. But now, Joe Biden, your whack president, and some of you all couldn't wait to go and cast your vote for Joe Biden. You couldn't wait. And Kamala Harris, you couldn't wait, because you wanted to get rid of Donald Trump so bad. And to be quite honest, man, I couldn't vote for either one of them devils, Joe Biden or Donald Trump. But you couldn't wait. He was your savior, and he had a black woman on his elbow. And he's gonna bring a better reputation back to the States, because Donald Trump just ruined it. He's so unpresidential, which I agree. He lies so much, which I agree. But now you got this Joe Biden, who's just as much of a liar, maybe even bigger than Donald Trump. He said, "Now, Brother Herman, you can't be talking about my president like that." Your president's a goddamn liar. He said during the presidential debates that he would never mandate a vaccine. That's what he said. He told Donna Lemonade, as my sister Vicky calls him, or Don Lemon, he told him that he would never mandate a vaccine. But now, that narrative has changed. And I want y'all to listen carefully to what he says, because America is supposed to be the center of freedom, justice, and equality. America is supposed to be that. There's a concept called American exceptionalism that gives America the right to police people all over the world, because no one has as many personal freedoms as citizens of the United States of America. That America is such a great place. It's such a beautiful democratic experiment that we're just exceptional. That's the thinking of these people. But, and so, on the heels of that, when now President Joe Biden, when he was Senator Joe Biden, was telling the American people that his goal was to bring people together, that we would always be able to exercise our own personal freedoms and personal choice, and that he wanted to heal the wounds that were opened during the presidency of Donald J. Trump. Now he's saying this. And pay very, very, very close attention to your so-called president.
First, we must increase vaccinations among the unvaccinated with new vaccination requirements. Of the nearly 80 million eligible Americans who have not gotten vaccinated, many said they were waiting for approval from the Food and Drug Administration, the FDA. Well, last month, the FDA granted that approval. So...
Wait. Let me stop right there. So, this is some trickeration. This is some straight trickeration. Your vaccines, Moderna, Pfizer, Johnson & Johnson, in Europe, AstraZeneca, are all investigational new drugs, meaning they have not been fully approved by the FDA. They were only approved for emergency use. And so your president is saying that one of them, Pfizer, has now been approved, so that's no longer an excuse. Keep in mind, drugs that are approved by the FDA usually go through a 5-year process, right? But this vaccine, or all of these vaccines, as we all know, were approved in quote unquote warp speed, which means they did not go through the rigorous FDA approval process. Carry on, President Biden.
Time for waiting is over. This summer, we made progress through the combination of vaccine requirements and incentives, as well as the FDA approval. 4 million more people got their first shot in August than they did in July. But we need to do more. This is not about freedom or personal choice. It's about protecting yourself and those around you.
Now, wait a minute. Did he just say this is not about freedom or personal choice? Wait a minute. Let me rewind that.
But we need to do more. This is not about freedom or personal choice. It's about protecting yourself and those around you, the people you work with, the people you care about, the people you love. My job as president is to protect all Americans. So tonight, I'm announcing that the Department of Labor is developing an emergency rule to require all employers with 100 or more employees that together employ over 80 million workers to ensure their workforces are fully vaccinated or show a negative test at least once a week. Some of the biggest companies are already requiring this. United Airlines, Disney, Tyson's Food, and even Fox News. The bottom line, we're going to protect vaccinated workers from unvaccinated coworkers. We're going to reduce the spread of COVID-19 by increasing the share of the workforce that is vaccinated in businesses all across America. My plan will extend the vaccination requirements that I previously issued in the healthcare field. Already, I've announced, we'll be requiring vaccinations at all nursing home workers who treat patients on Medicare and Medicaid because I have that federal authority. Tonight, I'm using that same authority to expand that to cover those who work in hospitals, home health care facilities, or other medical facilities, a total of 17 million health care workers. If you're seeking care at a health facility, you should be able to know that the people treating you are vaccinated. Simple, straightforward, period. Next, I will sign an executive order that will now require all executive branch federal employees to be vaccinated, all. And I've signed another executive order that will require federal contractors to do the same. If you want to work with the federal government and do business with us, get vaccinated. If you want to do business with the federal government, vaccinate your workforce. And tonight, I'm removing one of the last remaining obstacles that make it difficult for you to get vaccinated. The Department of Labor will require employers with 100 or more workers to give those workers paid time off to get vaccinated.
Did y'all hear what that man just said? It's not about freedom or personal choice. What about religious freedom, President Biden? What about medical freedom? What about your right to choose what it is that you put in your body? Now you're going to require all federal employees to be vaccinated? All? See, these are liars. What are you willing to sacrifice, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen? What are you willing to sacrifice? Because I just heard this man basically say that you no longer have religious freedom, you no longer have medical freedom, because it's in the best interest of the entire country that every single citizen or every single person in the country receive an experimental drug that they're calling a vaccine, a technology that has never been used before in human beings, messenger RNA technology. Y'all better pay attention. Are you so afraid of getting COVID that you would give up all of your rights? See, this is what I'm telling you. I'm telling you, family. The Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad is 1,000% correct. The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, 1,000% correct. We are in the fall of America. It is over. If you no longer have religious freedom, if you no longer have personal choice, it's over. And here's what I want to ask you. I got one more question. This is a show full of questions tonight. And if you're coming into the room, man, like, share, subscribe. If you're watching on Facebook Live, thumbs up, thumbs up, thumbs down. Love, like, don't like, laugh, smile. I don't care. Care. Whatever it is, just engage. Just engage, fam. Just engage. But I want to ask you a question, man. Because like I said, Pfizer's the only one that has full, quote unquote, FDA approval after less than 2 years. After less than a year being on the market. It's only been being administered for for 9 months, man. And they've got full FDA approval. When it normally takes 5 years to get full FDA approval. Or it'll take, in many cases, 10 years, depending upon the drug. Now, I want to break something down for you all, and then I want to ask you a question. Because if it's not, we won't even talk about Pfizer anymore. Let's DQ Pfizer, because they got full FDA approval. But we do have to question, how did they get full FDA approval? Whose hands did they have to wax? How much bread did they have to break? There's so many questions. So many questions. But the FDA, this we're going to school tonight, and I'm bringing the receipts. The FDA, before a drug is approved by the FDA, it's called an investigational new drug, or an IND. So if you and I came up with a vaccine tomorrow, or any sort of medication, until it's FDA approved, it's called an investigational new drug, or an IND. There is, like I said before, there is a rigorous amount of testing that has to be undergone before an IND, or an investigational new drug, can be fully approved. Right? I want to show you something. And before you think that I'm making something up, this is from the FDA's website. And then I want to ask a question after we read this. Just real briefly. Just indulge me. Okay, so phases of an investigation. This is for an IND, or an investigational new drug. An IND may be submitted for one or more phases of an investigation. The clinical investigation of a previously untested drug is generally divided into three phases. Although in general, the phases are conducted sequentially, they may overlap. These three phases of an investigation are as follows. Phase one includes the initial introduction of an investigational new drug into humans, right? Phase one studies are typically closely monitored and may be conducted in patients or normal volunteer subjects. These studies are designed to determine the metabolism and pharmacologic actions of the drugs in humans, the side effects associated with increasing doses, and if possible, to gain early evidence on effectiveness. During phase one, sufficient information about the drug's pharmacokinetics and pharmacological effects should be obtained to permit the design of well-controlled, scientifically valid phase two studies. The total number of subjects and patients included in phase one studies varies with the drug, but is generally in range of 20 to 80, right? That's phase one. Phase two. Right, phase one. Phase one studies also include studies of drug metabolism, structure, activity, relationships, and mechanism of action in humans, as well as studies in which investigational drugs are used as research tools to explore biological phenomena or disease processes. Now, this is some very scientific language, right? Phase two includes the controlled clinical studies conducted to evaluate the effectiveness of the drug for a particular indication or indications in patients with disease or condition under study and to determine the common short-term side effects and risk associated with the drug. Phase 2 studies are typically well-controlled, closely monitored, and conducted in a relatively small number of patients, usually involving no more than a several hundred subjects. All right. So I would say that phase 1 and phase 2 is what they talked about during Warp Speed, right? They had hundreds of people that they tested, right? But here, phase 3. What was Warp Speed? So I guess it's all included. Phase 3 studies are expanded, controlled, and uncontrolled trials. I'm going to say that again. Phase 3 studies are expanded, controlled, and uncontrolled trials. They are performed after preliminary evidence suggesting effectiveness of the drug has been obtained and are intended to gather the additional information about effectiveness and safety that is needed to evaluate the overall benefit-risk relationship of the drug and to provide an adequate basis for physician labeling. Phase 3 studies usually include from several hundred to several thousand subjects. Phase 3 studies usually include from several hundred to several thousand subjects. So my point of reading all of this, family, all of this, brothers and sisters, all of this, ladies and gentlemen, for all of you who got your vaccine, who got the jab, who went and sat down and let them stick whatever they stuck in your arm, which phase are you in? I would say that you're in phase 3 of them studying this investigational new drug. Because if you took Johnson & Johnson, if you took Moderna, hell, I'm going to say if you took Pfizer, because 9 months ain't enough for me for FDA approval. I don't know about you. But if you took it, you're in that investigational phase. Here's the question. I'm full of questions tonight. Here is the question. This is the biggest question. Because all of these drugs, in order to become FDA approved, they have to do these investigations. They have controlled and uncontrolled studies. But certain patients, they have to monitor. I'm going to say that again. Certain patients and studies have to be monitored. So, if you got your shot early, say you were one of the first ones who went down there and got it. Has anyone called you? Has anyone from Moderna, Pfizer, Johnson & Johnson? Has anyone called you and checked on you? What if you had side effects? What are the side effects of the vaccine? Surely, somebody has experienced side effects. Why do they never talk about the side effects? Not on ABC, not on NBC, not on CBS, not on Fox. You can't even talk about side effects on the internet or they'll shut your channel down. What are the side effects? And if you had side effects and you reported them, why don't we ever hear about them? Or if you had side effects, did you report them? if you had side effects, did anyone call you and ask you after you had your vaccination about your side effects? This is such a huge question, because they want us to all get the jab. Your president just said, man, we all got to get it. He's mandating it. Oh, lying Joe Biden. Oh, dirty Joe, who said he would never mandate that you get the vaccine. Now he's mandating it. Liar. He's just like the rest of them. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad told us there ain't no difference between no Democrat or no Republican. It's the same damn thing. Two sides of the same coin. My daughter-in-law, she took, I want to say the Moderna. First shot, her lymph nodes swole up. Lymph nodes, that's a serious side effect. She called her doctor. Her doctor said, don't take the second one. Obviously, if the first one does that to you. But guess what? Even though she called and reported it, Moderna never followed up. They never called to find out what the side effects were. So how do they know? The safety and effectiveness of a drug. How do they know about the efficacy if they never contact patients? All of you who've taken your shot. Did anyone ever call you? If your loved one died, did they say it was the shot that caused it? I guarantee you, no. See, they're using fear. But you have to ask the question. Look, man, I'm done. I just wanted to put that on your mind. And if you want to learn about investigational new drugs or INDs, the process by which all vaccines have to go through in order to be FDA approved, just go to the FDA's website, fda.gov. I'm not making none of this up. I can read. But now we have to make decisions, family. We have to make decisions, and the decisions that we make are either going to save our lives, or they're going to cost us our lives, or they're going to cost us someone who we love their life. But you're surrendering freedoms, man. We surrendered enough during this so-called Patriot Act in 9/11. Now you're surrendering, like Joe Biden said, your personal freedoms, your religious freedoms. Man, they got the right one in there. There's an agenda that's being run. I'm just asking a question. But listen, man, that's my time, fam. I'm getting out of here. I've been on here too long. And if they let this go out, because again, YouTube is threatening my channel, whatever, we'll find a way to make it happen. You could always go to astar2.com. I put my shows on my blog, and then we're gonna find other ways. You know, I'm on Instagram. I'm on Facebook. But YouTube is absolutely tyrannical with the way that they do things. They really are. Talk about freedom of speech. Freedom of speech, my ass. It don't exist on YouTube and on many of these social media platforms that are cutting people right and left just for asking questions. And that's all I'm doing, is asking questions. But anyway, fam, I'm gonna get off my soapbox. Listen, I'm going to give y'all a commercial. Go to, if you want to learn more about the Nation of Islam, please, please, please. I'm begging you. to save your own life, go to www.noi.org and learn about the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. The Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad always says in his, at the end of every chapter in his wonderful books, man, fly to Allah and come follow me. Come to God, man. That's what we need in this hour. We need God. If you want to learn about the Nation of Islam here in the city of Denver, Colorado, where I am the student minister of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, go to noidenver.org and, you know, hit me up if you want to learn more, and we'll get you involved in our processing class. I will be honored, of course, to take you through and teach you more about the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. It will be my honor and my pleasure. And do it before it's too late, fam. Do it before it's too late. Listen, I got a little commercial. I'm gonna show you my book. Wait, because you know we gotta pay for this. Brother Herman don't get paid for doing what he do. not on this interweb. But what do I want to show you? Oh, there it is. This is my book, How to Get Rich in the Barber Cosmetology Game Handbook. And just go to the website, man, astar2.com, and click on the link. You can get an ebook or a paperback edition of the book. And I have basically business and entrepreneurial principles in the book, with a specific emphasis on barbering and cosmetology. However, you can use it really in any small business, okay? So go ahead and support your brother. Look, man, let me, one more thing. I gotta advertise. NOI Denver, going back to NOI Denver. Boom, 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 so you can see what we got going on. Like the little ad says, all of the monies that are generated from any product that you buy at noidenver.org/shop go to our building fund. We want to build a mosque and a school in the city of Denver, and so that we can represent Islam as taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. But also, again, barbershop. Yep, astar2.com, man. That's me. That's where I'm at. If you want to book an appointment, get your hair cut, if you want to shop with us, if you want to see our blog, there's so much that we have on that site. It's really a one-stop shop for everything that's Supreme Style and Brother Herman Muhammad. So check that out as well. Listen, man, it's been a blast, man. I'm going to tell y'all, as I always tell you, if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. Peace. We're out. We're out. We'll see you on the next one. Hit us up with any information or questions. Love you.